serious drama. Serious drama, drama that has at least the objective of making a larger statement about life, I think sooner or later has to become involved in its time.
Lorraine Hansberry, writer, activist, and author, whose iconic play, A Raisin in the Sun, was the first written by a Black woman performed on Broadway. Hansberry's drama debuted in 1959 and was a critical success, earning her the prestigious New York Drama Critics Circle Award. At just 29, Hansberry was the youngest playwright to win. Now a new documentary by a Boston-based filmmaker reveals a deeper, intimate look at the prolific playwright's life beyond her most known work.
It's like I can see my future just stretched out in front of me, my whole future. A big, blank, empty space full of nothing.
Tonight, Lorraine Hansberry, bold writer, fierce activist, and much, much more. Welcome to our 50th season of Basic Black. Some of you are joining us on our live broadcast, and others of you are joining us on Facebook Live. I'm Callie Crossley, host of Under the Radar 89.7. Joining me tonight are Lisa Simmons, director of the Roxbury International Film Festival, Tracy Heather Strain, an award-winning writer and filmmaker of Sighted Eyes, Feeling Heart, the documentary about Lorraine Hansberry that will premiere later this month on PBS, Kim McLarin, Associate Professor of Writing, Literature, and Publishing at Emerson College, and Michael Jeffries, Associate Professor of American Studies at Wellesley College. Welcome to you all.
Thank you, Callie.
Great to be here.
Part of the promotional materials, Tracy Heather Strain, for your documentary says, if you think all you know is Raisin in the Sun, then you know nothing about Lorraine Hansberry. So tell us, broadly speaking, who was she?
Lorraine Hansberry was someone who was born on the south side of Chicago, and she's best known for A Raisin in the Sun, but what she really is to me is an activist artist, someone who really wanted to change the world and decided that she wanted to use art, specifically the theater, as her vehicle for doing that.
So why was this story so important for you to tell?
It's important to me because it's personally important to me. I was first introduced to Lorraine Hansberry by my grandmother because she took me and my sister to see the play To Be Young, Gifted, and Black in our hometown. And I was just really moved by her. I had never met a Black person, at least as presented in this play, that was so vibrant and speaking about issues that I'd thought about race and class and gender, and I'm sure I didn't even understand most of what was presented to me, but it really hit me hard and it stayed with me. And then years later, when I decided I wanted to take up Spike's call to make Black film, even though I wasn't a filmmaker yet.
That's Spike Lee.
Yes. I said, I think there should be a film about Lorraine Hansberry, so she kind of came back to me. So here we are many years later.
This has been marinating with you for some time. You've been working on it. You've all seen the film, mm-hmm. and I'd love to know, Lisa, first of all, you had a hand in casting a part of the film. So,
right.
Yeah,
that was wonderful.
When you saw the finished product and you knew something about Lorraine Hansberry before, of course, what'd you think?
Right. I thought it was amazing. I was lucky enough to have, be a little bit more of a part of that and to see some rough cuts of it. And as Tracy said, I think the most amazing part of it is that you come out of it thinking, oh my gosh, this woman was incredible and such a force and a political force and how important she was to the movement and the civil rights movement and other movements and other things that were going on. And to me, that was sort of like empowering. It was incredibly empowering to have her, all of her words and what she did and her friendships with other writers and activists at the time was incredible. Right. So I feel like I came away with, I think what Tracy wants everyone to come away with, this better understanding and a different understanding of Lorraine Hansberry. And to feel that now you know somebody so much better than you did before you went into it.
So in the last year or so, we've had an amazing documentary about James Baldwin.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I mean, we're seeing some looking back and looking deeply into some of our artists and activists, but a lot of people won't know Lorraine Hansberry. I mean, they'll know Raisin in the Sun, but they actually won't know her.
Right.
So what is the importance of having her story now at this time?
Oh, it's so important. I mean, they won't know her. Just as an aside, I mentioned I had my students read an Alice Walker story and they had no idea who she was. But then I said The Color Purple and they said, oh, I love that play. Right. Like they'd never read the novel, but they knew. So this is really vital to bring Lorraine Hansberry to a new audience. I thought this film was extraordinary. I did think I knew Lorraine Hansberry. I did not know her. Now I know her is extraordinary. And I think she I think it's important not only to introduce her and her work and A Raisin, which I think the film also makes me reconsider Raisin, which I think can be kind of trapped in amber in some ways, right? Mm-hmm. So it made me think of that fresh, which is extraordinary. But I also think she speaks to our time, to how art can, how all these students, and particularly my students who are artists, and often want to divorce their art from political and social justice. And she was so clear, especially for people of color, artists of color, that, as Du Bois said, all art is political despite the wailing of the purists, right? Mm-hmm. And also what importance it is for our narratives to be controlled by us. So she's just right on time. And I think the film is right on time.
So, Michael, what you do in your real life is to look at these contextual issues around culture. And so when you take a person like Lorraine Hansberry and take the fullness of her story as now been portrayed by Tracy, what are you left with as you think about who she was in her time and even who she might have been in this time?
Yeah, I'm going to start by coming back to some of your comments, Kim, because one of the things that struck me about the film is how many of the struggles and the issues, both with respect to national politics and the politics of the arts, are the exact same kinds of struggles that we have today. So when you say it's right on time, I wish we could pick her up and drop her into 2018, because we need her desperately right now. And I think that's the first piece of it that really struck me is she was insistent on the connection between the political sphere and the artistic sphere. So that's one piece of it. Then on the cultural side, when you talk about her work as a playwright, you've got to be able to look back, and I think the film does this so, so well, at all of the writing she did before then.
Right.
This was a person who woke up with a burning desire to write every single day.
Yes.
And she wrote lists for herself, almost kind of journaling. Mm-hmm. She wrote newspaper articles. She had that in her and produced so much before Raisin became what it was. And I think that's an important piece of this, too, is when we think about what writing is, right? It's not just a vocation that you do for some kind of production. It's something that most people do every day as a matter of living, as a matter of breathing, right? And that's I think, who she was first and foremost, was a writer, to the final moments of her life, even, when she's writing about her time ill.
Yes.
I think that's very.
I was gonna say I agree with that 100%. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was with my partner, and we're going like when she says, "I am a writer. I'm going to write." You know, you have to have that kind of burning desire. Mm-hmm. But I also wanted to say that I just lost my thought about what you said, so I'm gonna pass it off.
Yeah.
But the need to write. And I think it also brings her in, because we often say, well, it's unfortunate she only had this one. I mean, she had two plays, but the second one was less successful. So you might think this was a one-hit wonder in some way. Yes. And I think sometimes she gets reduced to that.
Yes.
So the fact that your point about her, all the writing that she did up to that, plus the anonymous writing she did, right? Mm-hmm. Or the pseudonyms, was really important, that even though this is her magnum opus, there's a lot that went around that.
Right.
So I think it's important to come back to the magnum opus, as you've said, because it was so amazing in its time because of she was a first on many levels. But the real heart of it was that nobody had seen this story before of real Black folks.
Right. Yeah. You know? Yeah. I mean, that it was so hard for them to get the play. People don't play produced. People forget that. They forget that, it's so successful now. It's put on all the time. Mm-hmm. But the first time was something so difficult and so unheard of. People thought it was a crazy idea to have Black people on the stage in a drama. okay, so musicals were okay some of the time, you know, and some other things maybe, but not a drama. And it's something that we have to remember, and I think sometimes we still have these issues around dramas and Black representation in films and television and what's considered normal and, you know, inappropriate for African-American writers, directors, and performers. So I think she, you know, it was totally groundbreaking. And the thing that's so interesting when you talk about Raisin and Sun being in the amber is that in part it's gotten in the amber because it was so successful that so many people who were white were, for the first time potentially, were identifying with the Black protagonist.
Right.
They didn't want the family to take the money, and they wanted them to move into their, you know, the house that they had purchased. And as Michael Anderson says in the in our documentary, these are the same people that would have probably been upset had a Black family moved next door to them in real life. And so it's interesting. I find it really fascinating to really, there's so much more we could have explored about Raisin in the Sun. But that notion of the reception of it and then how people decided to say, well, it's actually just universal. Mm-hmm. You know, this could have been any family.
At any time.
That's such an important point. I just want to jump in. The whole idea of universality, and I've actually written about this, and it's so important that she was one of the first, perhaps the first, to turn that on its head. On the one hand, it can be a dismissal of Black art, right? This could be anybody. And she insisted that it couldn't be anybody. It was any family. It was a very specific African-American family. But at the same time, it's extraordinary to make a Black family the universal, right? I mean, that's what Toni Morrison says. You have to write, the more specific you are in Black culture, by definition, the more universal she is. And she made people see that in a way that had not been seen before, I think. That's what's so extraordinary, right? So that's a plus.
That is a plus. I wanted to take another look, a clip from the film, because the truth that she was writing, that she made into art, was something that Black folks lived, and that in fact she lived. Mm-hmm. So let's just take a look, a clip from the documentary about Hansberry's life growing up in Chicago and how it influenced her life.
We live in a ghetto, which automatically means intimacy with all classes and all kinds of experiences. We are one people.
I want you to stand up tall and proud. I want you to speak up clear and loud.
All of these people, our parents, us, were stressed out because of race. Anger abounded because people were second-class citizens and reminded of it all the time. It became a part of our consciousness.
Our South Side is a place apart. My people are poor, and they are tired, and they are determined to live. Each piece of our living is a protest.
Baby.
So that's pretty powerful. And we should also add, as people will learn when they see the film, that her family actually took their case to the Supreme Court after they were being forced out of a neighborhood that was primarily white after her father had bought a house there. So this is very much real life in so many ways through the play and also the expression of Lorraine and who she was as an artist and what she was concerned about more broadly beyond the play. Mm-hmm.
Right, yeah. And it was really important for me and the team. I did not do this film alone. We had a team of people that did a lot of research. You see, you know, you look at these photos and things. It was really important for us to bring out the richness of the South Side and show the faces of the people that were later in her mind, you know, the kinds of people that would have been in her mind informing her and that she would be thinking of as she was writing A Raisin in the Sun. And even that music is Oscar Brown Jr., who was someone she knew from the South Side of Chicago. So we worked really hard to try to get you inside of Lorraine's head, and bring a representation of the African American experience that she had.
So in terms of getting inside Lorraine's head, what people will learn is that Lorraine Hansberry is much more, as we've said, than a raisin in the sun. And that, I mean, I think one of the things that always struck me was she's described early on as not a lefty, but a radical.
Right.
And I think it's she has such of that middle class black woman hairdo and presence that I think people thought, I'm being for real, right?
She's this right? nice girl, like, she's this nice woman, and she's going to be, you know, invite her to dinner. It's going to be great. But that for just one thing, that the end of that clip where she says, you know,
every word of our living is a protest.
Yeah. Right.
And that says it right there. I feel like that's who she was. And that's why when you said it's so relevant today, there are so many playwrights out there today, so many filmmakers out there today now who they might not say that, but sort of following in her footsteps in the way of telling these stories and giving voice to the voiceless and making sure that people understand that these experiences and their deep African-American experiences that people are going out to see, you know, in droves, like Get Out or something else like that, to say, oh my gosh, this is actually, let me see if not, and I don't know whether it's, let me see if I can understand the black experience, but let me see if I can figure this out and learn something or understand something. And maybe, you know, you guys can speak a little bit to that about how, but it's so much more prolific, whether it's in journalism, broadcast journalism, whether it's in documentary filmmaking, whether it's in narrative filmmaking, whether it's because Netflix and there's other opportunities for people to tell their real stories and tell their stories, that it just seems like there's much more of that.
Yeah, and what I thought, and maybe Michael can jump in here too, is getting back to what you were saying about her being not just a leftist, but a radical, which I didn't know, and which is very interesting. And, you know, one of the tragedies of her dying so young is that it would have been fascinating to see how she evolved and where she moved to in her very sharp critique of American society, right? And one of the things that was most striking to me, talk about relevant, is her critique of white liberalism, right, and white liberals, namely Robert Kennedy, which I knew about that famous meeting, but, like, you know, where was she... what is the role of that element in the perpetuation of the oppression of black people, right? So I thought that was fascinating. She was way to the left of where I thought she was, which was great.
And Michael, again, not just from her personal affect, but she might come off as an integrationist. She married a white guy.
Right.
They were pretty much in sync about, you know, let's work together and continue to work after they divorced later about, you know, what's important here in terms of addressing racism in the country. So from the outset, she doesn't look like she would be the one that's, you know, standing up, saying get out, I guess.
No question. And of course, we haven't even really discussed her private life.
That's
in terms
right.
of intimate
right.
relations
that's
and
part
her
of
queerness
it
and lesbian identity, right? And that's another part of the story that, you know, we really, when we learn about this play in high school, perhaps, or maybe even in a college course, we don't talk about that dimension of
not
her life at all, right? Because and to separate art from artist in that way does us such a disservice as fans and as critical thinkers about how this work is produced. And on the point of the point of radicalism, which you mentioned, one of the things that the film makes so clear is that from her earliest sort of strivings and thinking as a political thinker, she understands the black liberation struggle as connected to all of the other kinds of struggles that we're talking about, right? Colonialism and its effect.
Exactly.
The women's movement and sexism more broadly. She doesn't really talk about the queer movement much, which of course is nascent, and the film does a wonderful job talking about the depth of the oppression and the shame associated with homosexuality at that time. But that's what makes it liberatory and radical, right? Is that she refuses to stay in one lane, and in fact gains steam the more she recognizes connections between black liberation and women's liberation and so on and so forth.
She was intersectional before.
About Tracy's film is that you got to see that. I mean, it was really clear about who she was and what she was dealing with and how she dealt with that and how she felt about it. And that's what I think. And the whole thing around homosexuality and her, you know, sort of living between these two worlds was...
Parallel lives.
I know, right. But I know that it was an issue when you were making this film or getting the rights and doing anything. Was it sort of telling this story that was so central to who she was as a person?
Let me pick up on that and say, was there a great amount of pushback against, you know, redefining what people's idea of her would be?
No, No, I don't think there was no pushback. I think that the thing was, we had to create this story from the primary and secondary resources that in the research that we did, because there is no major biography out yet that has had access to our papers, so we're sort of like the first people out of the gate with something sort of, you know, on a larger scale. We didn't have pushback because not that many people have had access to these materials to even know what's there to push back or say, oh, you're doing too much of this or that, or you didn't include, you know, this paper or that paper, because a lot of people haven't seen this material.
Just from an idea of who people thought she was.
So far, we haven't had any pushback. But what drove us was, I think, drove me, was seeing that picture of her with the pearls on, and you know, she just looks like, I always describe it as the embodiment of middle class, African American aspiration in the middle of the civil rights movement. That's what people thought she was,
right.
A lot of people who see her as an icon, that's what she represents. I can be successful. She wrote this successful play.
Right.
I'm going to go out and I'm going to be successful, which is not it's a good thing, but that's not who she was. You know, that's the thing about an icon. That's not a person.
Right.
And so it was really important for me to present this person that was very multidimensional. And I say very, she's organically a part of the major movements during her lifetime.
Yes, exactly.
I did not have to like squeeze her into anything.
Yeah,
you
right.
could, you know, the Great Migration, the Great Depression,
it's
you know, World War II,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
the Cold War, yeah, you know, yeah. Civil Rights Movement, women, you know, it's right. just, and there's things I had to leave out, you know, that she was a part of. And so we didn't get any push. In fact, people who have seen the film, you know, some people have questioned, you know, why we didn't talk more maybe about her sexuality why we didn't interview, you know, certain people. But, you know, everyone who you might want to be in your film doesn't always agree camera.
That's right. Do any of you think that, you know, because we have a complicated relationship in the African-American community about still today with homosexuality. So do you think as people learn the whole Lorraine Hansberry, there'll be, you know, some feeling about, wait a minute, how do I begin to look at her legacy now?
I think it's more like here's just another dimension of her. I mean, I think so much of this film for me was like revelation after revelation after revelation. And so, and all in a positive way. Like Tracy said, you know, you created Lorraine Hansberry, the person, not the icon.
Yeah.
And that's what came forth. And so I just think about it like being taught in schools and doing clips of it. And, you know, there's so much more to the world around her that that comes out from this film. So, and that's just a piece of it. And I can't imagine that people are pushing back because of that. I think you're just more informed, and it just shapes your view of her based on everything else she did, you know, and like Tracy said, all these movements that she was a part of.
Yeah.
It makes you go, oh, this is who she is. Wow.
I don't think so. I think that the film does such a great job of reimbuing her, reanimating her in her full humanity. And one thing that I thought about after watching the film was, because I've read Baldwin, who of course loved her and wrote about her extensively, and at one point he said something about she did not have personal ambition. She had race ambition. She was a race woman, right? Mm-hmm. She had drive for the people, and that comes through so clear. She was living for the people, and that was so powerful. So you know, all those dimensions of her lives are just enrichment of that motivation. She was very clearly for the people, and the movie shows that.
Do you agree?
Absolutely. I mean, in particular with respect to her ambitions and kind of her status as an icon in her time, humble is the wrong word, but she, and unassuming is probably the wrong word too, but she was reluctant to occupy the spotlight, right? And there's a beautiful clip in the film about this first standing ovation that the play gets, right? And her reluctance to take credit for it, right?
Yeah.
And then when she's pulled in and starts being interviewed and so on and so forth, her inability to turn down these requests, not out of a sense of narcissism, but because she just wants to engage with people, as you said, and with respect to the homophobia in the black community thing, I mean, I think we need to be careful about just assuming that the quality of homophobia when we're talking about black folks is somehow different or exempt or more severe than homophobia and sexism, in other parts of the world and other societies, right? So black queerness, there may be some differences with respect to black queerness and the way black folk discuss queerness, but to assume, right, that there's going to be a natural pushback, in particular in 2018, I don't think that's a safe assumption at all. Yeah.
I think some people would be surprised to learn that she was a communist. So
when we say radical, we mean all the way. She went everywhere in doing that. All right. Well, I think the legacy, as we might have thought about her in the past, of this sort of one play definition, has been exploded by what you have done here, and that's a powerful thing to have happen because. We really need to know more about, you know, our intellectuals, our artists, our activists. We need to understand, you know, what the meaning is, it fuller than just their representation in one piece of work. Mm-hmm. So if we can do nothing else, if you didn't do anything else, you did that, but you did much more. That's the end of our show. Thanks to all of my guests for joining me, and thank you for joining us. Now, you want to stay with us right now as we continue our conversation about Sighted Eyes, Feeling Heart, the new Lorraine Hansberry documentary we've been discussing here. We'll talk about it on Facebook Live. You want to know what took Tracy so long to make this come together? Thank you so much. Good night.